कैन से इट डज हैव ऑटोमेटिक गार्बेज कलेक्शन. इट सपोर्ट्स ऑटोमेटिक गार्बेज कलेक्शन. इट सपोर्ट्स एक्सेप्शन हैंडलिंग. हाउ टू इंस्टॉल दैट ऑन विंडोज? दैट इज विद द हेल्प ऑफ दिस वेबसाइट, दैट इज www.python.org. फ्रॉम दैट यू कैन डाउनलोड exe फाइल एंड देन यू कैन इंस्टॉल ऑन विंडोज. If it is Ubuntu, you can use sudo apt-get install Python 3.8, that is the latest version, or otherwise you can download the tar.gz file of the latest version. Then after you can extract and do follow whatever instructions are there in it. We can check whether the Python is installed or not with the help of RPM minus QA Python, or otherwise not this way, then you can directly type Python on the command prompt, that is terminal, and you can check it out. This is the screen for our Python download page. So what is typical way of programming? Write program, run it with some input. Is output okay? If no, write program. If yes, more inputs. If no, finish. If yes, more inputs. If yes, run it with some input. If no, write program. So we want to start programming with Python. So begin with any text editor and create settest.py. Then we can run it. The Python files are having extension as py. So are we going to write these py files? Are we going to use the text editors? No. For this particular workshop, we are going to write all the programs in Jupyter notebook. This is just to let you know that if we have returned the first program to print hello world, in the text file in Ubuntu, we need to provide its path, that is Python interpreter path. And typically it is /user/bpython. So that we can provide with the help of !! and the path. After that, we need to write our Python program. So let us say that for simple print hello world, we need to write this simple line, that is print hello world. And if we want to run it from the terminal, we can use it as python test.py, and we will be able to see the output as hello world. So what sort of editors we can use with Python language? They are Sublime Text, Spider, Python IDLE, PyCharm, and Jupyter Notebook. There can be many more, but we are going to use Anaconda's Jupyter Notebook. So, before knowing use of print, first of all, let us see the print hello world program in Jupyter Notebook. So, I am showing you that. Here is our file, that is day1_1 jupup-2020. Now here is our file wherein I have run all the cells and all the things are available with the output. So what we want to see? We want to see how to do hello world print with our Python program. So what we are doing is print in double quotes hello world. How to run that is known to you. Just show you that. Click on the cell and after that you can do run. So it will give you the output that is available here. So we are able to see it as the output, that is hello world. If we want to print value of a variable, how to have the variable? That is, as we are having in other languages, like whatever is the identifier, say var is equal to 2. So many people will be thinking that in C, in Java, we are having something like integer A is equal to something. Character C is equal to something. So why not that data type is over here? That way the Python is very good. It doesn't need to have any declaration of variables. The way you are using them, it will take that value. So that is cool language, isn't it? That's why people are preferring Python these days. Print variable, this is the text we want to display, and we can use the comma, and this variable name, this is var, and we will be able to see the output as var space 2. Whenever we are using comma, it will put one space here, and then after we'll be able to see the value of this variable. If we want to do the addition of two variables, let's say print, say 2 plus 2 equal to, I want to see the result. So comma 2 plus 2. So we'll be able to see the result as 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. Now if we want to do the multiplication, what we will do? That is 2 multiply by 3 is equal to comma 2 multiply by 3 comma 4 multiply by 5 in double quotes. Whatever we are writing in double quotes, that will be printed as it is. And whenever we are doing multiplication or any other operation, its result will be printed directly. So here we can say 2 multiply by 3, it is this particular string, this equal. In double quotes, that is what is being printed here. The result, that is 2 multiply by 3, 6, we are able to see here. And 4 multiply by 5, that is equal to 20. So that's what we are able to see here. So these are the programs which we have seen. If you want to read from the PDF, just read, you can use this particular thing. And if you want to run it, you want to see, you want to change something, you should open the Jupyter notebook file. So now we want to see input, that is scanf in C, right? So we want to take input from the user. So how we can do that? For that, we do have the function available in Python, that is input. Now, if I want to display some text, that is if I want to instruct the user, that is enter your age or enter number or anything like that, then we should use the double quotes and whatever string we want to display to the user. Let's see that in the Jupyter notebook file. Here we can say num is equal to input enter your age. So let me run this. So it is asking me enter your age. This star here shows the processing. It is waiting. It is because we haven't yet entered the data for it. Till that time it is processing only. For other cells, it will give you the number. So you can understand whenever it is showing you star, it means that cell is processing. So here, if I'm giving the value, say 6 and enter. So this is, we have entered the age. After that, you can say we want to print it. So we will go to this particular cell and we will run it. So whatever is the number over here, it will take the value and it will print the value here. That is, your age is 6. So we haven't declared any data type. तो कैन वी नो व्हाट द टाइप ऑफ डेटा इज? यस वी कैन नो. हाउ? दैट इज विद द हेल्प ऑफ फंक्शन दैट इज टाइप. Type, we want to know the type. So how to know the type? For that, here let's first know what are the standard data types in Python language. Numbers, that is integer, float, long, etc., etc. String, that is whatever is there in the double quotes or in single quote, and in triple quotes also, but that is called the doc string. It is a different thing. List, it consists of a number of values separated by commas in square bracket. Tuple consists of a number of values separated by commas in round bracket, that is parenthesis. Sets, they are the unordered collection of data separated by comma, but they are there in the curly braces. Dictionary, it is a set of key value pairs with the requirement that the keys are unique. So people are saying the major tasks in Python in different way also. So what they are saying is, they are saying them as the scalar or non-scalar. What do we mean by scalar or non-scalar? Objects that do not have internal structure, that is like integer, float, bool, that is boolean, non-type, these are the scalar types. None type is a special type with a value. The value is none. Non-scalar. So for that, what we say is objects having internal structure like a string, list, tuple, dictionary, sets, and user-defined classes are of non-scalar type. So find a type of a number. For that, instead of looking at the code in the PDF file, we will see in the Jupyter notebook file. So we'll be able to see it. And if you want, we can run that also. Here, what I am doing, I am using the function that is type of file. And I am printing it. So print type of file. We are able to see it as class integer. Why it is class? It should be something like simple primitive data type. That is integer, float, character, double, something like that. The way we are having in C or Java. Then why it is class? Because here we consider everything is class, everything is object. Now, print type of -10. So what it gives? It gives class as integer. Print type of 10.5. It is float. Print type of true. People may think if you are writing in small letters, it will do. No, 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 no. This language is case sensitive. And for Boolean, we need to consider it as true, T capital, or false, F capital. So if we are giving for this type, it will give us the boolean, that is bool. Type of double quotes, hi, Ami. It says its type is class str, that is of type string. Print type of 3 is not equal to 2. What is this? What is this? 3 is not equal to 2. Is it true or false? It is false. So it is of type boolean. Print integer of 2.5. Now what is this? Is it a new function? No. We want to learn type conversion. type conversion if you want to do, here in Python, we need to provide integer or whatsoever type to which we want to convert. We need to give that name. In the parenthesis, we need to provide the value which we want to convert to, say integer here. If it is another type, we need to convert it to other type. So we can say print integer of 2.5, that will give us 2 as the output, because integer part of this one is 2. If we are doing for 2.3, we will be getting it as 2. If we are running it for integer of 3.9, it will give us the 3 as the output. Now, what if we are giving float 3? 3 to integer, why? But what we are doing is, we are converting that to float. So, we'll be getting the output as 3.0. We are not getting it as 3, we are getting it as 3.0. It is because it is float. Print integer of, in single quotes, 75. To kya? It is string. But what it gives us? 75. Because it is converted, this string 75 is converted to integer. It is nothing like it is taking the ASCII value. It has converted this text to integer, and that is 75. What if we are giving something like this? Print integer of single quote ABCD. Can we convert this ABCD to 75, 76, 77, 78? No, we cannot. This is ABCD. We cannot convert it to something like this. So it will give us the error, that is value error. This will be used when we will learn the exceptions. So input method to accept a string. See, when we are doing A is equal to input, and we are providing the text to instruct our user, that is enter number. This accepts string. It doesn't accept integer. Now see, what happens? If we are doing A is equal to input, enter number, and say I am giving the number as A. Now, if I am doing print adding 5 to A, that is A plus 5, what should it give us? Should it consider this A to some ASCII value and then do addition? No. We have seen that if it is string, it will not be converted. If it is string which is understood to integer, something like this, 75, then it will be converted. But if it is ABCD, it will not be converted. If it is this A, it will also not be converted. And if we are doing A plus 5, it will give us the error, that is type error. So what we do is, what we have to do, that is we have to convert this string to integer, and then after we'll be able to edit, that is add 5. So here we'll be giving the input as something like 5 or 7 or any integer variable, and then after we will be able to add the value 5. So if we directly want to get integer input only, we should use this type conversion here. Directly with this input, you can see till now I have written some text inside this input function. So here it is not written. It is not written because we do not want to provide it. It's okay, no issue. Let me run this. It is not giving us any text. Till now it was giving us text, something like enter number, enter your age, something like that was there. If you want to instruct your user, you should use it text. But if not, we should directly take the input. And if we want to convert that input to integer and want to store it in one variable, we should use it as integer. Inside the parenthesis we will be using input. Now if I am giving it as 5, enter. Now I should run this, run. So what it gives me? It gives me adding 5 to A. So this A is equal to 5 is given here. So 5 plus 5 and we are getting it as 10. So this type conversion examples we have seen. We want to know the formatted print. That is a way we are having in our C language. But before that, concat number and string. How to do that? See, A is equal to 10. B is equal to Ami. C is equal to str of A plus B. Str of A. A kya hai? A is 10. What is B? B is double quotes Ami. So if I want to concat this number and this string, what should I do? I should convert this number to string using str of A plus this B, and then if we print it, we will be able to see the output. Let me run this. A is equal to 10. If I am running this, so we'll be able to get it as 10 Ami. Now we want to know about the formatted print. Let's see that. Here we can say formatted print. So how do we do? For example, if we are having in C language, we were having something like printf, right? But here in Python, it is print. So what we are giving is, it is not having syntax exactly same, but the interpretation is same. So I'm saying about C language, if we have percentage 5D and percentage 8.2F, what is its representation? It is, if it is percentage 5D, so what will happen that say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, say 5 boxes are there, then you can say that this 4, 5, 3, this value will be taken at last, that is 4, 5, 3. At the right hand side, we are writing the value. And first two spaces will be blank. It is because we are having positive 5D. If we are having say 59.058, for that, what is the case? That it is 8.2, right? So total 8 is there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now it is positive 8.2. So what we need to do is, from the right hand side, we'll be writing the values, that is 0.06. And after that, we are writing these values, that is 59 point. So this way, you can say the number was 59.058. And here I have written it is 0.06. It is because we want to have 0.2. This is 8.2. So after decimal, we want to have only two digits. Here it is given the three digits, and that is why it is converted to 0.06. So this way, interpretation is known to us. If it is negative, we know that this first digits will be written with 4, 5, 3, and right hand side will be kept blank. So how this thing is written in Python? This is what is the concept in C. That's what we want to use in Python. So how we can do that? We will be using print function. Inside that, suppose I want to write it as art colon percentage 5D. This is the text I am giving. In double quotes, I am giving the text. And whatever is the space it should take, That's what I have provided here. That is for art. Whatever value I'll be giving, it should consider percentage 5D. So it should be having something like this. That is 453. And what about other price per unit? For that, I am giving percentage 8.2F. Double quotes over now. String modulo operator, that is percentage. After that, in the parenthesis, separated by comma, I am giving the values for how many values should I provide? I should provide for whatever number of percentages are used inside this double quotes. Here, percentage 5D and percentage 8.2F. So we need to provide two values here. So after percentage, in parenthesis, we'll be giving two values. And we will be getting the output for that. So how will it be printed? But before that, we know this thing, that is D for signed integer, I for signed integer decimal, O for octal, U for obsolete and equivalent to D, X is for hexadecimal, E is for exponential, F is for floating point. These things are known to us. C is for single character. This is known to us. Now we want to see the output. That is, let's see in our Jupyter Notebook file. Let's see here. Let us run this. It gives us art. See here, the spaces are more. It is not only one. When comma is there, we will be able to see one space, but here it is having one, two, three, right? So more spaces are there, and that is because of percentage 5D. Same is the case for this percentage 8.2F. We are able to see more spaces here. You can see that. So now operators in Python. For arithmetic, we can say plus, minus, multiplication, division, remainder operator. Two more are there. What are they? There's two slashes. What is that? It is integer division. This is star star. What is that? It is 1 raised to 2. No. Not 1 raised to 2. Number 1 raised to number 2. Comparison operators. Equal. Not equal. Greater than. Less than. Greater than or equal to. Less than or equal to. Assignment. Equal. Plus equal. Minus equal. Multiply equal. Integer division equal, divide by equal, remainder equal, raise to equal for logical, and or not, bitwise is and or, this is exclusive or, this is negative, this is right shift, this is left shift. Membership, that is whether in or not in. Identity operators are is and is not. And before seeing the examples of these operators, let us know about the identifiers. We have directly started with the variable var is equal to something and those things, but we should now know what are the rules of identifiers. So they are similar to that of C. That is, we can have the variable name which can have underscore in it, digits or numbers, or you can say letters are there, but first must be the letter. It cannot be the number. These are the invalid things. It is because phi is first, max space profit, special characters are not there, left dot 7, this is invalid. So these things are known to you, the way we are having in our C language, same is over here. So can we have only 8 characters or 16 characters as the maximum length of variable? No. This is Python. It does not have any limit. You can have any length as the variable name. So what should we have? Should we have the variable name as max or maximum? It depends on you, but max is preferable. Identifiers are unlimited in length, but style guide of Python says that the line limit is 79 characters, so we should have the variable name maximum of the length, that is 79 characters. So now we want to see the assignment operators and all those things, and for them I'll again take you to the Jupyter notebook. Here, let me run all the cell below, so we'll be able to see the output. And from where we want to start, that is from arithmetic, right? So say A is equal to 5, B is equal to 7, print A plus B. So we'll be getting it as 12. Print A minus B. So we'll be getting it as minus 2. Print A multiply by B. So we'll be getting it as 35. Print A divide by B. So we are getting this as the answer. Integer division. So suppose I am giving 25. 2 slashes B, we are getting the output as 3. We are not getting something like 0 point something or that way, but we are getting integer division as the output. Remainder, A remainder B. So we are getting it as 5. A star star B, that is A raised to B. So say 2 raised to 3 is 8. So this way it is being calculated. Now for comparison, if you want to check, A is less than B. What is A? What is A? What is A? What is A? A is 5 and B is 7. 5 and 7. 5 is less than 7. It is true. If it is equal to less than or equal to, if it is less than, it is true. Less than or equal to is also true. Print A greater than B, it is reverse of this, so it is false. Print A is greater than or equal to B, this is also false. A is equal to B, 5 cannot be equal to 7, so it is false. Print A is not equal to B, definitely it is true. For assignment, say C is equal to A, A was 5. So C is 5. C plus or equal to 5. So 5 plus 5, 10. So we'll be getting output as 10. Now C minus equal to 5. You may think it was 5, but here it was changed. Now it is having value as 10. 10 minus 5 is 5. So it is giving you output as 5. Now C is 5. What we are doing is C multiply by equal to 5. So 5 multiply by 5 is 25. Now 25 remainder 6, that will be equal to 1. Divide by equal to, that is 0.2. Raise to, it is giving you this output. Integer division, for that suppose we are giving C as 21. C integer division 5, we are getting it as 4. Now for logical, what we are having, L1 is true and L2 is false, print L1 and L2. So it is false because we know that true and true is only true. For OR, L1 or L2, it is true. For NOT, it is only negating. For bitwise operations, what we have is, say B1 is equal to 25. So what it will do is, it will convert it to, say 11001, and for this also it will convert to binary, and then after it will do the bitwise operations. So here we can say that it is ending So we'll be getting the output as this, but it will not give you this output. It will give you the output that is 8. So whatever is the output, it will convert to decimal, and then after it will give you the output. If you want to do the OR operation, we can say B1 or B2, exclusive OR, that is B1 hat B2. This is negation operation. This is right shift operator. This is left shift operator. Now for identity operators, let's say that we want to know type of A. So what is the type of A? It is integer. If you want to check is operator, that is identity operator, for that we can say print type of A is integer. Here we are not giving it as single quote. We are only giving it as integer. So it is checking whether the type of A is integer or not. This is identity operator. So it says it is true. Is not operator, for that we say that type of A is not integer, it is integer. So it will give us the result as false. Membership operator, this we can understand if we know list, that is one data structure available in Python. Let me just give you one example because we want to know this particular operator. Let us say that list is comma separated values inside this square bracket. So what we want to know whether 5 is there in this particular list or not. So let me run this and this run. So what it says, 5 is it there in this list? Yes, it is there. So we can say that 5 is there in the list. So it will return true. 7 is there in this list? No, it is not. So we'll be able to see the result of this as false. Same way we want to check the other operator, that is not in operator, that is also called the identity operator. And for that, say 5 not in L, it is there. So it will return false. For 7, if you want to check 7 not in L, it is true. So it gives us the operator, that is membership operator. What was the identity operator? That was is not, is and is not. And what is membership operator? That is in and not in. For conditional, we want to write the if else or if else if else, the way we are having in other languages. These expressions, all the things we have seen. Precedence of operators is there in this particular list. You can see and try yourself. If this example is there, then what should be the result that is being calculated here? So we want to know about the conditionals and loops. So for that, here the syntax is there. This is one special thing in Python. If we are giving x comma y is equal to 5 comma 10, what it does? The first value will be given to x and second value will be given to y. So here we can say x is equal to 5 and y is equal to 10. If else. Now one special thing about Python is it considers the proper indentation. It does not have anything like curly braces to keep the code inside that particular thing. So what we have to do is we have to give proper indentation. Otherwise, it will give you error. Let me first show you the proper code, then I'll make it wrong and will show you. Here we are checking if x is less than y. If you want, you can write parentheses. It is actually not required, but people are habitual of writing parentheses in other languages, so you can write, no issue. But After that, you need to write colon. It is must. If you are not writing, it will not consider whatever code after that is inside this if. So this colon is must. After that, if I want this print text is part of this if, I should give proper indentation, and then after I should write print text. Now I want else should be there. So I'll be writing else. Again, colon is required. And if I want that this print y is there inside this else, I should give proper indentation. Then only I can write print y. Now you can say, what about this? Here there is nothing like indentation. It is similar to this if. It is similar to this x. It is similar to this else. So it is not part of if as well as it is not part of else. It is our simple code which we are writing in our main. So if we run this particular cell, what we will be able to see? For y, we can say what it says. What we are saying is, if x is less than y, is it there? Y is less than 1? No, it is not. So, what will be there? Print y. What is y? It is 1. So, this 1 is printed. After that, in single quote, it is y. So, y is printed. And then after is minimum. So, that is what the output we are getting. Now, let me make this wrong by removing this indentation. Now, let me run this particular cell. It is giving us error. Indentation error. Expected and indented block. Right? So, we can understand that here it is required. This tab is required. But, in simple editors, it may work. Here, many a times, it need to have something like this. So, here you can copy this. Control C, copy. And here, I'll be giving you Control V. So, after that, you can have something like this. Now I can run it, run this cell. So I'll be getting the output and no error. Fine. So if you want to find minimum of three numbers, what we are doing is, if first of all, let us take the values for all three variables. And very simply, we can have this here. Don't you think Python is very good language? It is a cool language, isn't it? So x comma y comma z is equal to 115. So x will be having 115, y will be having this 100, and z will be having 150. If x is less than or equal to y, if x is less than or equal to z, print x, otherwise print z. So you can see the proper indentation is required. If you miss that, it will give you the error, that is indentation error. So always take care of proper indentation while you are writing Python program. So this is for if. Inside that, if else, that is nested if is there, then else, for that also we are having something like this, and the output is 100. Now say we want to have if else. So for that, we can have the values of x, y, z. Now, if the condition we want to have with and, so that's what we are having. Then we can say print, then else if. No. Here it is elif. So there also the condition is that we are giving the colon. This is must. After that, whatever actions you want, that is print, or you want to do some operations, you can do. Else, after that also colon is required, and we are getting the output, that is this. This is what is for precedence of operators which we have seen. Now, one more example of if else. What is new in that? Let's see. X is equal to 0.1 multiply by 3. So what should be the answer? It should be 0.3, isn't it? But float representation will say it as 0.3000, some zeros, and after that it is 4. Is it something like that? See, it depends on language and the way that particular variable, that particular value is represented in that system. So what we are doing is, if x is equal to 0.3, we can say definitely it is having the value as 0.3 only. So it should print fly. But when you run this, it print it as slip. Oh, this is totally wrong, isn't it? No. It is because our x value is this. That is not equal to 0.3. It is more than that of 0.3, isn't it? So we are not able to see the output as this, and we are able to see the output as this. That is called the float representation, and it is always the case with all sort of languages. Now, what I am doing is, if 5 greater than 6 or 6 greater than 5, if condition is there, fine, colon. After that I have written okay. What is okay? Is it keyword in Python? No. Not okay. Is it keyword in Python? No, it is not so. Let's see what is the output we are getting if we run this. No output. So what to do? See, people may write it something like this. It is because they are thinking the logic and they are writing it. But it will not give you the output. If you want to see the output, you will have to use print statement. Y is equal to 0.1 multiply by 3. If y is not equal to 0.3, print launch a missile. Here we will be able to see the output as this and not this. You will say, ma'am, indentation, where is it? If you are writing in the next line, I have to put the proper indentation. But what did I do? It is only having one line, so I have written it from here. So it's fine. No issue. So 0.3, obviously y is not having value as 0.3. We have seen that it can be having 0.3, few zeros and 4 or 5 or anything, depends on whatever implementation it is using. So we can say when we are checking not equal, that condition is true. So that is the float representation. Now, this conditionals, all these things we have seen. Precedence example also we have seen, this conditional float representation. Now we want to know about loops. For loop has range in it. Range is a function where we are having, say, three parameters. S, this is starting. E, that is end. And D means distance. If it is having two parameters, we can say S is starting, D is end, and we can say distance will be there. If it is E, we can say S is 0. What is the distance? Distance is by default 1. If we haven't provided that value, this is D here in one parameter, as well as over here also it is 1. So the way we are writing is, for variable in whatever sequence we are saying and whatever statements we want to write, colon also is must, and proper indentation, that also is must. So we want to know the syntax and we want to run that also. So for that, now I'm closing this file and opening other one, that is day1_2. The Python programs are divided in two files. This is the second one. Now, for loop, we want to know, say, n is equal to 5. For I in range of 1 comma 11. So start is given, end is given, and no distance is given. So distance by default is 1. So what we are doing is print n. N is 5 comma. So one space will be there. In double quotes, multiplication. So multiplication symbol will be printed. Then I. I is having the range which is from 1 to 11. So is it going to take 1 to 11? No. It will consider 1 inclusive and 11 exclusive. That means it will have 1 to 10 only. It will not consider 11. So that I will be there. After that, this equal because we want to see this sign here. And multiply by I. That is the table of I we want to print. So we can say if we are having this syntax, we will be able to see the output as 5 into 1 is equal to 5. 5 into 2 is equal to 10. Till 5 into 10 is equal to 50. Now, say if we are giving for I in range of 1 to 5. So it will take the values from 1, 2, 3, 4. Is it going to take value 5? No, 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 because it is exclusive. So 1 to 4 values it will take and it will do print 1.0 divided by I. So it will be giving us the float output. Now one more type of loop which is available here is while loop. Say count is equal to 1. While count is less than or equal to 10, colon, print, count and equal to double quotes colon. Now this is the special thing which is used with print. What is print in Python? That is whatever you provide inside double quotes in print, it will print that value and new line. If we want that new line should not be there and that statement should end with set dot. Here as we are giving, say end is equal to double quotes dot. This is what is required many a times in NPTEL certification programs. At that time we have to use this, and that's why I have given you this particular example that you will be able to know this and you can try for those NPTEL certifications also. So what we are doing, count is equal to count plus 1. So it is similar to our for loop as we know in C or Java or any other language. It is same. The thing is the way the syntax is written. So it is while count is less than or equal to 10, colon is required. After that, for increment and decrement, we have to write it ourselves. And here the print, the way it is being returned, that and should be with dot. So we can say the output we will be getting it as 1 dot 2 dot 3 dot till 10 dot. It is because while count is less than or equal to 10. Now we do have one more, that is while else. So what is the case? It is where when the condition of while false, it comes here. So let's say that A is equal to eval input, it evaluates the expression which is given here. Eval input enter number. While A is greater than 10, print A and is equal to dot. A is equal to A minus 1. When this condition falls, it comes to else, and so we will be able to get the output. But if we have entered the number as 50, if here A is equal to 15, what we need to do is while a is greater than 10. So 15 is greater than 10. So it will enter. So 15, 14, 13, 12, 11. Till that time it will run. And after that, it will print this else part, that is false condition for our loop. As we have talked, that for tuple we are having, say, list, which is separated by comma and which is there inside the parenthesis, right? So say we want to have one example with for. Say if we are having for I in this tuple, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, colon, print I. So it will take one by one value of this tuple and it will print it here. This is one example of geometric progression where we are taking the input for R, A and N. This R and A we need to have float and this we need to have integer. So what we are doing is that we are running with the help of for. So for that the equation is term is equal to term multiplied by R and we are printing that term. So we will be able to have the values here, fine. So we want to know about nested for loop. Nested for loop, that means loop inside loop. Indentation is required. Proper indentation is always required for Python. So take care of it. So for I in range of 1 to 9, so it will consider 1 to 8 only. For j in range of 1 to 6, so it will consider from 1 to 5. So what we are printing, I multiply by j, ends, what it ends? It ends with space that we are giving with the help of end equal to in single quotes or in double quotes, space. And after that I am giving print, it is because I want to give the new line after each inner loop. So it is giving me, say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I multiply by j is there. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, then 3, 6, 9, 12, 15. That way for 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now, this is the example with AND only. That is, AND is equal to dot. You can use it as colon or whatever you want. But if you do not want to see the output as multiple lines and you just want to see in the one line output, you can use this. But not always. You should always read to the problem statement. What is given in that, that only you should use. In NPTEL assignments, it is required for all the cases, that is for any language, if it is Java or C or Python, this is what is required during submission of NPTEL assignments. Which I can say it is because I have cleared C language, Java language with top 5% in India, and for Python also I have cleared with top 6% in India. If we do not want to have any separator, the way we have taken here, AND is equal to dot, AND is equal to space. Here we do not want to have any space, any dot, then you can directly give it as AND is equal to, in single quote, nothing is there. So we'll be able to see the output as 1, 2, 3, 3, 4, 5. We are having nested loop, colon is required and proper indentation 2 is required. Here you can see it is inside this inner for loop. So when loop is there, we should have the idea about break and continue. So for that, it is same as we are having in other language. I is equal to 0. Say while I is less than or equal to 10, I is equal to I plus 1. If I remainder 2 is equal to 0, continue. What we say, I remainder 2 is equal to 0, that means even numbers. For even numbers, we'll be skipping. That is, we will continue. And after that, we can say we will print the I. So we can say we will be able to print the odd numbers, which is less than 10. That was the example of continue. Now we want to see the example of break. So say R, comma A, comma N is equal to 2, comma 10, comma 20. So term is equal to A. So what we get? A is middle value, so we will be able to get it as 10. Now, for I in range of n, what is n? N is 20. Term is equal to term multiplied by r. If I is greater than 3, we will do break. So, what we are getting? Print term. This print term is not part of this if. It is not part of this for loop. It is outside them. So you can say it is part of our main function, right? So you can say that it gives us the output that is say 320. So our for loop, all the examples we have seen. Nested loop also we have seen. Break and continue we have just seen. Now, the next topic which we want to know is functions. An independent, self-contained entity of a program that performs a well-defined task. That is, if you want to do the addition multiple times, instead of writing the code again and again, it is preferable to make separate function. So how to write the function? For that, the syntax is DEF, define. DEF, after that, whatever is the function or method name, and inside the parenthesis, we will be providing the variables which are being passed to this particular method. You can say in C we used to give it as integer or float or double, but here there is nothing like that. No declaration is required. So here we will not give it as integer A or integer B and only the variable names. After that we can say return say A plus B. So it will do the addition. How we can call this method? That is say print. It is because we want to print a value which is being returned, or otherwise we can call it with add and the parameters, that is add inside that 5, 4. So we are calling this function or method, but before calling this function, it must be declared. No, it must be defined. Here there is no requirement of declaring the function. We just have to define that, and this is the syntax of it. That is def method name, parameters, colon, proper indentation, and if you want to return something that we need to provide. So let's see the examples with our Jupyter notebook. Let's see that. So here are the function, right? So first function, def add a comma b. So this function receives two parameters, that is a and b, and it returns a plus b. So what we are passing? 5 and 4. So we'll be getting the output as 9, because it is 5 plus 4 and we will be able to get it as 9. Now say, if we are giving the string, any string is there. So what is the string? Suppose hello world. So before calling this function, we must be having the definition of it. So how we are getting it? That is def, that is we are defining that function or method, print string, whatever name you want, This is the parameter colon print whatever is given as a parameter. So we'll be able to print it as hello world. If we are having say four variables, x1, x2, x3, x4. You can say why I have written this 4 here and other things in other cell. It is because you can separate and you can understand it very easily that whatever code is there, what it tries to tell you. So for that, here are we having y1 is equal to minimum of x1 comma x2 that is directly available in Python. y2 is equal to minimum of x3 x4. y3 is equal to x1 plus x2 minus y1. y4 is equal to something is given. x3 plus x4 minus y2. y5 is equal to max of y3 and y4. To print maximum of x1, x2, x3, x4, that is the value 5, we are able to get through this particular logic. You can say why to do something like this. If we have the method available that is only for say two parameters and we want to apply some logic. So for that, this is the special case. Very nice question. We have to do this calculation. After that, we can understand that it is giving us max of x1, x2, x3, x4. Very nice question that was there in NPTEL. Now, when we know functions, we should know about asset keyword also. What is that? Let's see the example. We can have the idea. X is equal to hello. Assert x is equal to hello. What does that mean? If condition returns true, then nothing happens. If condition returns false, assertion error is raised. So assert x is equal to goodbye. Now see, the thing is, what we want to understand about this is x is equal to hello. So if somebody checks, forget about this assert, just check about this condition, x is equal to hello. We know that x is having the value as hello only. So x is equal to hello, it returns true. So what we say, if condition returns true, then nothing happens. So we'll not get any output, but that is running fine. But if it is not running fine, we can say we will be having the SSN error. So if for this second statement, x is equal to goodbye. Now we know that x is having value that is hello. It does not have the value is equal to goodbye. So it will check whether this x is having this value or not. We know that the value of this expression is false. So it will raise the assertion error exception. So that's what we will be having over here. SSN error. Now, x is equal to hello. Assert x is equal to goodbye. Is it true? Let's see. X is hello. X is equal to goodbye. Hello is equal to goodbye. Can it be? No. It cannot be. So it will be false. So what do we want is, when it is false, we know that SSN error is raised, but we want that with the SSN error, it should give some message also. So for that, we can say we are giving the message after this comma, that is X should be hello. So we will be getting the output as SSN error, but we will be getting this message also. So that's what you can see here. SSN error, X should be hello. So now we want to know about the scope rules. Say, define the function that is max a1 comma b1. m1 is equal to 0. So what is the scope of this m1 is equal to 0? It will be accessed inside this function only. It will not be accessed outside. So what we are doing, m1 is equal to 0. If this condition is true, we will do m1 is equal to a1. Otherwise, we will do m1 is equal to b1. And we will return m1. Here, we do have other function, that is say main a2 and b2. m2 is equal to 0. So what is the scope of this particular variable? That is only inside this particular function. So m2 is equal to a2 and m2 is equal to b2. So if we run this, how to run this? It is, we will call the method, whatever we want to call. Here I call say print max 5, 7, so it will return us 7. If we are calling minimum of 5, 7, it will return 5. Now, nested function. We do have function inside function, that is called the nested function. So def outer function, parameter is there, colon is there. So after that, you can say that the definition of that function should be there. So what is there after? After that, we want to nest other function inside this function. So proper indentation is there. Then def nested function. What we do? Print text. Text, text. Is it been passed? No, it is there to outer function. Let's see. Now what we are doing is, we are calling nested function. Is it part of this definition? No, it is not part. We can see from the indentation. It is not part of nested function, but it is part of outer function. We are calling nested function. After that, you can see the indentation of outer function. That is similar to that of this def. So you can say it is called to the function. That is outer function. We are providing the parameter that is hi. So that text is being passed here. So this text is text. Now after that, what is there? What is there? The definition is there. It is calling this function. So it will print text. And what is text? It is this one which is being passed. So we will be able to have the hi. Now, call by value and call by reference. Call by value is something like integer, float, double, something like this. And what is call by reference? It is say string or list or something like that. Let's see that. Call by value is for integer, float, bool, something like that. Simple values are there. When we are having string, list, tuple, any collection type, then we can say they are called by the reference. That is object as reference. So what could we write for that? Let's see that. Here, call by value, what we are having. Definition of function accepts name and role, and that's what we are printing over here. We are calling that function with the help of parameters, that is name is equal to Ami and role is equal to mentor. You can see we haven't used it something like this till now. It's okay. Till now we were directly giving the values. Now we are giving it as variable name is equal to value. That means if instead of this, I am giving it as role is equal to mentor first and name is equal to Ami next, then too it will consider name is equal to name and role is equal to role only. So for that, we are giving the name is equal to value pairs for calling the function. Def main. Do we have to write main for each and every Python file? No, it is not required. But people are habitual of writing main in C language, in Java language, and they think it should be there in Python also. So we can say we are writing the main function. Now what we are doing inside this is we are calling this myfun. So we are calling the function, we are providing the values. Name is equal to something and role is equal to something. Now myfun we are calling by different values. So you can say name is equal to value, and again this name, that is role is equal to teacher, is not required. It is not compulsory, but people do not remember what was the first parameter, what was the second parameter. It's better to give it as name is equal to value. So that way, for those people, this facility is also there in Python, and that's why the Python is cool language. It gives us joy of programming. It does not make us feel horrible by the name Python snake, isn't it? So let us call the function again with the help of one more value, and we will be able to see the output. That is first of all what we are doing. This was the function definition. After that, the function call was there, where it was Ami mentor. So it will be printed first. That is Ami colon mentor. We have printed it as with the help of name in double quotes colon and comma role. So it is something like name, whatever is that, then in double quotes colon, and then after the role. So that way it will print. And so we can say Ami colon mentor. Space has to be there. It is because we have provided the comma here. Now, after that, what we are having? We are having the definition of the main method. But are we calling that? Yes. Where are we calling? After this function call, this is definition. After that, we are having function call, and that is myfun name is equal to Abhay and role is equal to businessman. So we will be able to see Abhay and businessman as the next line. After that, we are having call to main function. So it will come here and will call myfun with name is equal to Ayushi and role is equal to teacher. So we will be able to see next output as Ayushi teacher. What after that? It is calling this function with Prithvi and Raja. So we will be able to have Prithvi colon Raja as the output. Call by reference. Now what is that? For that, we need to have star available here. So do we have something like pointers here? No. Do not confuse with that. This is object reference. So what we are doing is, let's say def student, and we are having star arg. For I in arg colon print I, and we want that the argument should be separated by colon. So that's what we are giving with and is equal to colon. We want to give the new line, so we are giving print. After that, def main, our main method. So what we are giving? Student 10. We are calling this particular function with one argument, that is 10. Student 10, 20, that is we are calling with two parameters, and student with 10, 20, 30, three parameters. Oh God. So is it going to give us the error? No way. So what will be there? When we are giving something like this, it will consider, it is object, reference, right? So it will consider that object here. When one value is there, it will print only one. For two values, it will consider two values here, that is object. For three values, it will consider three values here. So we'll be able to see the output as 10 colon for first one, for second one, 10 colon 20, for third one, 10 colon 20 colon 30. Always the end is with colon, it is because we have given it as end colon this one. Now you want to know about global variable. Why do we require that? It is because when function is there, we always consider local variables. What if we want to have the global variable? So for that, we need to use the global as a keyword. Let's see that. Globals allow functions to communicate with each other directly without parameter passing or return value. Convenient when two functions want to share the data without any direct caller or callee function. And for that, we need to use the keyword, that is global. Let's see that the example. Instead of seeing the example here, it is preferable we'll see through our Jupyter notebook file. So count is equal to 5. Count is equal to 5. We haven't yet declared it as global. What we are doing? We are having the function, that is increment, with no parameters in it. I am saying count as global. Now, what I am doing, count is equal to count plus 1. Now, next function, that is decrement. There also I am saying global count. And I am doing count is equal to count minus 1. So what happens? I am calling the function, that is increment. Then I am printing count. I am calling the function, that is decrement, and then printing the count. So let's see. First of all, the value was 5. Now I said it is global. Now what we are doing is count is equal to count plus 1. So after this, if we are trying to print, we will get the value as 6. In the decrement, that is after this, we are calling the function, that is decrement. In that, we have again said use the global count. So the global count value is 6. And what we are doing is we are decrementing that. After that, we are printing the count, that is the value as 5. So this is the example of global variable. So now, for scope variables, scope rules, one example is that where I have said factor is equal to 10. Factor is equal to 10. Now what? Definition of f function with the r parameter, return factor multiply by r. Definition, update factor. Factor is equal to 16. This is the definition. Now let us see how we are calling them. We are calling them as f is equal to x is equal to f of 5. That means here we are passing r as 5. What is factor? Factor is 10. 10 multiply by 5. So here we'll be getting it as 50. If we are calling update factor, what we are having. We are updating that to factor is equal to 16. So what should we get as x and y? That is this x and this y. What should we get? We are getting it as 50-50. Aisa kaise ho gaya? It is because, what do we have? Are we having this factor 16 as effect? No, because it is local parameter or local variable to update factor. It is not global value. So it only considers the value which we are having, that is 10 into 5 and that is 50. So for both x and y, we are getting the value as 50. Now here, if we say m is equal to 10, definition of double which says return m plus m. Now, print double of 7, comma double of m. So what it gives us? Actually, m is 10. But when we are calling the double function with 7 and with m, it takes the value whichever is being passed here, that is for first one it is 7. So 7 plus 7 is 14, and for second it considers the value of m, that is whatever was declared here. So it will consider 10 plus 10 and we are able to see the output as 20. So these are the scope rules which we need to consider. So globals. Now, we want to know data types in detail. What do you mean by that? We have talked of number as one data type, but then we have discussed with that only. We haven't talked of more about string, tuple, list, set, dictionary. So this is what we want to know in detail. So for that, string have the type str in Python. It does have the single quote or double quote. With plus, we can concatenate two strings. With star, we can repeat that strings that many number of times. For that, we should see the string operations, and that too we will see in our Jupyter notebook. So let's see the example. Name is equal to double quote Sami Choksi. I want to know the length of this particular string. So what I do? I'm printing the length, and for that the function is len len, and providing name. So it gives me output as 10. But what about this? In single quote, I told you the string in Python can be there in single quote or double quote. So here I can provide in single quote also, say 1, backslash n, 2. So 1 is counted as 1, backslash n is counted as 2, and 2 is counted as 3. So length of this particular string is 3. Now concatenate and repeat we want to know. Say designation is equal to name. What is name? Name is Amishaksi, right? So we want to know name plus in double quotes apostrophe s, that is I want to see something like Amishaksi's designation is associate professor. So for that, we are giving something in double quotes and we want to concatenate that. So we just have to do plus and we will be able to get the output as whole string being concatenated, that is Amitrox's designation is associate professor, right? After that, if we want to have repetition, that is, if I want name should be repeated 5 times, so I should use it as star, that is multiplication operator, name multiply 5. So it will give us Ami space Choksi 1 time, this is 2nd time, 3rd time, 4th time, and 5th time. Now, let's say we want to know about string operations. So say one more function with that is split. If we want to split, we want to part the string by a particular character, we can use the split function. So how we use it, that is, say for example, one string is given in double quotes, my colon name, colon is colon Ami. Now C is equal to B dot split. It will give us the list, but which is separated with the character, that is colon. And we will print C. So we will see the output as my, then name, then is, then Ami. So it is being splitted. For converting the string to upper and lower, the functions are upper and lower. So say S is equal to Ami. We are printing that string. After that, S dot upper. Now see, you cannot directly print S dot upper. It will not give you, the S. Means, people are thinking that we can change to S string. No, it is not changing S string. It will do upper, that is, it will convert the string to uppercase, but that we need to store in other variable. It is not changing to S itself. It will change to other variable. Actually not changing, but we will be able to store the result in other variable. So if we are printing that variable, will be getting it as capital, and if we are doing the same thing for lower, we'll be able to get it as lowercase string. Here the special case is given that AMY slash single quote S plus PEN. So what is the output of this? This is one character and we can count that. 1A, 2M, 3Y, this is 4, this is 5, this is 6, 7, 8. So this way it considers. Now if you want to see the string indexing, that is, with the index also we will be able to get the characters of the string. One by one character if you want to get, we can use, say name is equal to acads. In single quote I have written, as we know in Python we can write with single quotes and double quotes. So print name of 0, so first character will be there. Name of 3, so 3 plus 1, no, 3 minus 1. What do you say? We say that this is 0, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3. So we will be getting it as D. If I am giving it as name minus 1, now what is this minus? Minus is starting from the right hand side. Minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5. So if we are giving minus 1, we will be able to get it as S. Hello of 1, what is that? That is, this string is there for that first index. First index is one number index I am talking of. I am not talking of index as 0. It is saying that index as 1. So this is 0 and this is 1. So we'll get the output as E. If we want to do the string slicing, that is, if we want to print say name 0:3, it means from 0 to 3 minus 1, all the characters we should take. This is starting index, this is end index, but end index we need to exclude. So we can say 0 to 2. So for this we can say 0, 1, 2. So Ami will be printed. If you are not providing the first index, should it give error? No. No need to have something like that. So what it says, forget about the first, but the last one is 3 minus 1. So it will again give us the Ami only. Now, if we are giving the first index as 3, that means starting from 3 to what is end? End is not given. So go till end. So we can say 0, 1, 2 and 3. So from 3 it has to start. So choxy whole will be printed. Now no start, no end, nothing is given. Fine. So consider whole string. So some more slicing. -4, -1, -4, -1. -4 matlab 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So what we have to do is start from here. O, K, S. Because for last one, we will have less 1. So say -4 and what we are giving is no end here. So starting from that -4 and going till whole end. Same way if we are giving say -4 and 8. So what to do? -4 is what? 1, 2, 3, 4. So we are starting from that. So that way we can see all the slicing. Now, pass string to function. We know that how to define the function. We just want to pass the function to, we want to pass string to function. So how we can do that? Say definition of print words of s, and whatever is the definition inside that, what we do is st is equal to the string is given here and print words st. So we will be able to pass this particular string to this function. What we are doing inside that, words is equal to s dot split. We are splitting the word. But delimiter is not given, separator is not given, then by default it is space. So it separates all these words with a space. That means this string is separated by the space and all the words we will be getting. So after that we are printing all the words. Now next data type which we want to learn is tuple. So for tuple we know that it is written inside the parenthesis. It is also the list. It is also the list that is separated by comma. No need to have all the values of the same data type, but it is written inside the parenthesis. What more about tuples? Let's see tuples. What it says? Consists of a number of values separated by commas and which are written inside this parenthesis. So let's see our programs. Here is one tuple. T is equal to intro to tuples, army chalk C and 20. Three values are given. What we are doing? For I in range of 0 to 3, what we are doing is print T of I. The way we were having string indexing, here also we can have the tuple indexing, and that is being accessed as T of I. The way we are accessing array in other languages, we can have the same thing here. So after that, we are printing the T. And then after, print type of T. So what we are getting for that? Intro to tuples. What we say is intro to tuples. Then after, army chalk C. Then after, 20. What is that? These are the three things which we are printed with this. After that, whole T. Whole T, that means whole tuple is being printed. After that, a type is printed, so that is class tuple. After that, what we are doing is we are giving C is equal to two parentheses. No values are there. That means it is empty tuple. If we print C, we can get the value, that is two blank parentheses. Now, singleton, what is that? When tuple is having only one value, we must end that with comma. That must end with comma, otherwise it will not be considered as tuple. So, we need to write singleton is equal to, say, one comma in the parenthesis, nested tuple. So, tuple inside tuple, isn't it? Yeah. So, course is equal to Python, comma, parentheses are required. So, Python, Dr. Ami Chokse, and 20. Now, after that, what I want is student is equal to issue 20, and the last one is course. So, what we are doing is, for student, the tuple value will be issue is there, 20 is there, and after that the course. So, whole this tuple is added in this particular place. So, if we print this student, what we will get as the output, that is, say, issue 20 and whole this tuple inside the parenthesis. So, course is fully part of this student. That's what is the nested tuple. If we print the length of the course 1, 2, 3. So, we can see we are able to get the length as 3. That is length. And what about this student? For that, it should be 1, then 2, then 3, 4, 5. No, it is not so. It is because this is first one, this is second one, and this whole is a part. So, it is considered as the length is equal to 3. If we give tuple as parenthesis, that means blank, empty tuple, what is the length of it? Its length is 0. If it is singleton tuple, that is 1 comma, what is the length of it? Its length is 1. Now say concatenation. Course is equal to pi ami 20, that is a tuple. One more tuple is there, dmac 30. Now we want to concatenate that. So what we are doing is course plus course 1 plus course 2. So, what we are getting is output. It is complete list is there and it is there as a tuple. Multiply if we do, what we are doing is 2 multiply by course 2, or if you are doing course 2 multiply by 2, it is something like where the tuple is being repeated twice. So you can see the output will get as DMAC30, DMAC30. So the tuple is repeated twice. Now if you want to unpack the sequence, what we can do is, first of all, let's say that this course and student is given to us. If we print student, we will be able to get as this one. Now what I want is, I want to unpack this sequence. So tuple is given and we want to get one by one value. So what we do is, we are taking three variables and that is equal to student. So first index will be given to name, second index will be given to role, and third index will be given to REG course. So now after this, if we are printing, it will give us first as name, second is that is Ebu. Then we can say that what about the second, that will give us the 10, and for third we will be able to get whole tuple which we have given here. So that is the third value which we are getting from here. So if it is tuple and we want to get the separate thing, we can get it this way. 1, 2, 3 variables, that is equal to student. If we do have x1, x2, x3, x4 is equal to MEC. So A is given to x1, M is given to x2, I is given to x3, and C is given to x4. Yeah, but if we are giving it as something like this, that is x1, x2, x3, x4 is equal to double quotes AMI, it will give you error because not enough values are there. If we are having x, y, then 1, 2, 4, one more tuple is there, that is you can say nested tuple is there. If we print y, it will take first value, that is 4. If we are having simple x comma y is equal to 1 comma 2 comma 4 as the tuple part of this tuple, then you can say if we are printing y, we will be able to get it as 2, 4. If we are having x comma y is equal to these two values, and if we are trying to print y, we will get it as this value. Same way for this x comma y1 comma y2, that is equal to hello comma double quotes ak. Now what is the case? For first one, it should take this value, but for next one, it does have two values inside it. So if we print y1, it will take a, and if we print y2, it will take k. If we want to pass tuple to function, we can say definition of it, that is def print tuple elements t. For I in t, print I. We are only printing the tuples. And we are giving the tuple as tp is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We are calling this function, that is print tuple elements. We are passing this tuple. It will print one by one element as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The thing is, directly we have passed this tuple. It is as object. If you want to pass two tuples, we can say def print tuple elements t1 comma t2. For I in t1, print I, and for I in t2, print I. So we are passing two tuples and we are printing all the elements of tuple. So how we can do that? Print tuple elements, we are passing two tuples, that is 1, 2, this first one, second one is 4, 5. So we'll be able to get 1, 2, 3, 4 as we have printed the elements of each and every tuple. Now, we want to know about list. We already talked of list is the comma separated values inside the square bracket. So here, say we are having the list as x is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, comma, double quotes, 5. Here also the thing is, we do not have all the data types as similar inside list. You can have anything what you want. So x is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. W is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Y is equal to 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 in digits. For Z also it is having the same value. Now if I do x dot append, the list operations we want to do. So we want to apply the functions which are available in Python. Few of them we will see. Let's say x dot append. Append will do what? It will append the y to x, but it is appending as a whole list inside it. That is, we can say nested list. So what if I want to get it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 continuously as one single list? What should I do? I should use other function, that is extend. You can see when we are doing extend, it gives us the output as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 as a simple list. When we want nested list, we should use the append. And if we want, that also adds the element at the end. Extend also adds the element at the end. But the difference is, when append is there, it appends a list as part of that list. And extend adds, it flattens the list and add them as the member of that list. So the examples are there for extend and append. Now here, x is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Y is equal to 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. What we were doing here? If we do x dot append y, it will print none. It is because when I say w extend y or x append y, what it does, it changes to x directly. It changes to w directly. It does not return anything. So if you are trying to print after doing append operation, it will say none, because it does not return anything. Now say one more example, wherein we do have the list, where is, say, Pinko, Tinko, Chinko, Tony, Sony. What we want is, we want to get the list which for the letters, sorry, for words which are having U as the last letter. So what we are doing, for I in names, if, that is the way we are iterating our list, I in names, if I minus 1, it is slicing, is it? No, it is index. It is indexing the way we are having for tuple, for string, the same ways for list. So I minus 1 is equal to U. If it is so, what we do is, we are printing that. So we will be able to see it as Pinku, Tinku, Chinku. One more example, we want to see the join method. So what it does, let's see. We want list to string, that is using join. So how we do is, say we are having the list available that we have printed also. So we can see the output. What we are doing is, B is equal to single quote, nothing is there in it, but that way we have said it is string, dot join, and then we are giving the list. So all the elements of this list will be joined to this particular string, that is P. So after that, if we are printing, we will be able to get it as my name is Ami. So few more operations. If I see x is equal to 1 2 3 4 5, if I see the index x of 0, I'll get 1, x of 4 is 5, length of this particular x is 5, x of minus 1, that is negative indexing, this is slicing, this is what we have already seen, right? If we are doing x plus y and we are giving it to z, what it does, it is doing something like extend. So it flattens the list and adding it. If we do 2 multiply by x, that means it will repetitively add it. So 2 times we will be able to see the same list. If we are having x is equal to some list, if we print it, we will be able to get the whole list. If we want to pass list to a function, what we do is define print list ll1 comma ll2 for I in ll1, print I, and same for ll2. So we are passing two lists to a function and we are printing them separately. That is very simple. We can provide list1 and comma list2. So it is passed as object reference. One will be given to ll1, second will be given to ll2, and we will be able to get the output as 1 2 3 4. Mutable and unmutable. For that we should know for tuple and list, the key difference is that the tuple are immutable. Unmutable, that means they are not getting changed. Once you have created, you cannot change it. But if it is list, you can change its elements. But tuple elements, we cannot change. So tuples look like list, but it is written inside the parenthesis. Tuples and strings are immutable. I will not change, right? List are mutable. So now, mutable and immutable, or people are saying it as unmutable also. Indoor is equal to one list is given. For outdoor also one list is given. If we are giving games is equal to indoor and outdoor, we have combined that. If we print games, we will be able to have two lists, which we can see here. Two lists are combined. Cards is equal to sol, hearts, free cell. If we print game of 0, we will be able to get what is over here. So that is this one, whole list. Games 1 is equal to indoor, outdoor, and cards. Indoor, whole list, outdoor, whole list, cards, whole list. So we'll be able to see 3 lists available in games 1. If we give something like this, the end is 2 minus 1. So 0 and 1 index will be printed. This we have combined. So we'll be able to get this and this combined in the list. But as we have given in the tuple, we can see that it is starting with parenthesis, ends also with the parenthesis, but two lists are part of it. If we want to change the outdoor, we can change that is equal to outdoor of 0 is equal to hockey. That is a list which is changeable, mutable. So we can change it very easily like this. Change to list will change tuple which reference it. That is there. Though the tuple is not changeable, but change to list will change tuple which it reference. So the here is the example. Indoor is equal to badminton, table tennis, carom, and games is equal to the thing is given. If badminton in indoor, true, otherwise it is false. If we have indoor and outdoor, if you want to indoor and outdoor and say games, if you want to print all of them, that is we want to iterate them, we can say for I in games we can print all elements. If you want to append, we have already seen v1.append, we can give the value. List comprehension, what is that? We are having list wherein we are giving some expression and we can create that.